Like a flood of rain. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. trapped inside. Oh God, we are people, oh God, you are Lord. We are your people, oh God, you are Lord. We are your people, oh God, you are Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you. Of you, answer by fire as we worship you, answer in your glory as we worship you, answer by fire as we worship you, Lord, oh God, almighty God. God and Savior, Almighty God and King, we worship you. Oh, we worship you. We worship you with the blood of Jesus Christ. We worship you in the spirit of truth. We worship you by the Holy Ghost and power. We worship you as those who are redeemed. Oh God, we worship you. Oh Lord, we worship you. Oh God. Glory of your name, your signs and wonders, the glory of your power, your signs and wonders as we worship you, oh God, as we worship you, oh Lord. As we worship you, for we are your people, oh God, you are Lord. Oh, we are your people, oh God, and you are Lord. Our Lord. Ora ye mai olosi, ki la 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 boru mama lo la mana, shigara boyo mala le pira boyo si, mala alohu mani, shibra ye mala ye malo. Open up the gates. Open up the door to your heart. Open up the gates. and the King of glory shall come in. And the King of glory shall come in. And the King of glory shall come in. Open up the gates of your heart. Open up the gates of your life. Open up the gates of your heart. The King shall arise. Let God arise in you. Let his rivers flow out now. Let God arise in you. Let his wellspring overwhelm your soul. Let God arise in you. Oh, with his power. I'll sing and you do it. Let God arise in you, Kayalamunjai, with the heavenly showers. Father, we come to touch you now. Oh God, we come to worship you. To bow down before you, God. To worship and adore you. To bow down before you, Lord. To worship and adore you. Oh God, you are our God. Father, we are your people. Oh God, you are our God. Lord, we are your sheep. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Chambra bakuti tita la lama abramas.
Sing praises to the Lord.
shout of praise. Watch all doubt and fear subside and go away as you praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him. All you people, praise Him. Mana nemi goro soto lola de kira mama neni nena no mosu dia nana ma bebre bebe biki do lolo lo musu brava ye. Zora sande ra mama no lo baku sere beki sera lo baku ra mama no lo mosu bebe biki do lolo. Kira na manje. Kira na manje. Your rivers, oh God, your rivers, oh God. I'm hungry and thirsty, I demand, oh God. To see, oh God, I will not sit silent. I demand the rivers, I demand the sea, oh God. The great pouring. Oh Lord, we will not sit in silence waiting for someone else to be a champion, to be valiant, to walk in truth. We will demand of ourselves these rivers. We will demand of our own life this expression. We will demand of ourselves that which you commanded. Oh Lord. So hungry, so thirsty. All that which only you can give, oh God. So hungry, so thirsty. Oh, that which you alone can give. Oh, God. Father wants to become bigger to you than a distraction. Think about it. Hungry and thirsty. Oh God, your glory, oh God, your splendor, your power, your beauty, and all that you describe to me to be, oh God, I'm hungry. Hungry, oh God, and thirsty. Hungry. Right now, by and large, the church is in a state where the world can write us off as nothing more than religious, no different from anyone else. True. No, they will change it. It's those who become hungry and thirsty for the things that God desires to do. People, that begins right here in this place of worship, but then it transcends over into the place where you don't get to do your own will anymore, where you don't get to have your own bad attitudes anymore. You don't get to have your own complaints and spirit of offense anymore, your own issues anymore. You're just caught away up in heaven. You don't have your own worries anymore. Everybody wants to get rid of them anyways, hopefully. You don't have your own concerns anymore. Hallelujah, because you've cast them all upon Him who loves you. Father says, bring them to me. Oh, how He cares for us. He's numbered every hair upon our head. He's even done more than that in Psalms 139. He got all excited about how He Himself personally tailor-made and fashioned every little part, every toenail, fingernail, eyelash, eyebrow, iris, lips, everything about us.
And his desires being so towards men, he said, I see your uprisings, your downsettings. I've set you before and behind. Lo, there's not even a word in your tongue, except for I know it all together. Oh. I mean, just think about how passionate God is about getting this thing underway that we try to make a religion out of. Oh, my, 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 my. Father, we thank you tonight that you cause every person in this place to be able to see clearly. Oh, God, to be able to enter into that realm with you. That you demand. God's not going to allow fake. He's not going to allow it. And if you've got anything going on in your life that's not of truth, of love, of his goodness, of the Spirit, he wants it out. He wants it removed. The only way it can be removed is by repentance and by the blood of the Lamb, and then you're allowed to come in. Otherwise, you're an outsider. I don't care how much you sing, how much you worship, how much you praise, how much you give, how many times you go to church, whether your mama, your daddy, your grandfather, grandparents, all the way back to Adam were preachers, it does not even matter. God's not going to allow anything in that's not pure. And the beautiful thing that he did for you and me is he gave to us the ability to simply repent and take a hold of the blood of Jesus Christ and become as pure as you need to be. As pure can be. White as white. Whiter than any fuller soap can make it. But people want to hold on to their stuff. They want to hold on to their issues. They want to hold on to their own rights. Today, tonight, I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll let those go. There's not a person in this place that right now you don't know that you're without understanding because the Spirit of the Lord is here. You might try to duck and hide. You might say he's talking about me and I don't agree with him. But nonetheless, there's still a response of, yes, that's me. No matter how it is, there's still a response of, yes, that's me. And as far as I'm concerned, everybody who's right says, yes, oh God, I come to you. Lord, wash me right now. I let go of everything. I don't hold on to anything. It's a wrong heart and a wrong attitude that says he's talking about me or whatever, you know. It's a wrong attitude. The right response is not to men, but to God. And the right response to God is, yes, Father, I let everything go. I thank you that you washed me, that you've loosed me. You've loosed me. Loosed me. And you've let me go. You've loosed me and you let me come into your presence. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Can you turn up the mic? Is there any problem with that? Can you turn up the mic? It's on. Hallelujah. It doesn't sound like it's on, but it really is. As far as my switches go, if you could just turn it up, kind of make it like this mic, then I could set this mic down, take the Bible in my hand. No, don't let it be restrained. Let it be unleashed. About what God is doing. I felt a long time ago to take the most passionate people in the place who pray the loudest, sing the loudest, scream the loudest in the presence of God, put them in leadership. Let everybody follow them. That's it. Somebody said, what do I need to do to get in leadership? You need to pray louder. Worship more extravagantly, you in leadership. And I just, you know, the Lord's just been releasing me in my spirit to see some, to ordain some elders in the place. So, you know, when you find people who will serve you and honor you and you're no longer just a peer, and you've got people who honor and submit to the Lord that can lead God's people. You know, and I'm just so blessed to see what God is doing. There's so many of you, you know, I can't make everybody, you know, elders and deacons, but we're gonna see the Lord just take a whole new, you know, whole new approach to this thing. You know, I'm just so blessed with what's going on in Jeremiah Graham's life every year. I just said, you know what, he's just elders, he's just an elder. Anybody's going to serve and honor the anointing in such a way that serve and honor God. They would think that they're doing an interaction for men. They look for the approval of men. It ain't nothing to do with anything. That's a bad heart. And I praise God can fix your bad heart quickly. with repentance but blood of the Lamb, you can get right. And you can then say, Lord, I've been taught all my life by man how to behave. And now I want to learn how to behave. Basically, I want to learn how to behave from you. Holy Ghost, I want to learn proper behavior. Hallelujah. I tell you, there's not a time in this place, time ever in the meeting, that I don't just absolutely get so blessed by Jacqueline. Because of this the Holy Ghost flow that's going on. As far as I'm concerned, we'll just turn the ministry. As far as I'm concerned, just turn the ministry over to her. No, because I'll show you need. You don't need all of these things that people think they need. All you need is a passion and a cry towards God, and He'll take you and step you over into a realm where He's speaking through you. Now you have the wisdom of the ages, where He's operating through you. And God's leaving no one out. I'm just showing you, and I'm just telling you, I mean, I am so blessed by this front row. Just cutting loose. I don't see anybody who's got the damn control. You know what I'm saying? The remote damn control, where they start to go, thank you, Lord. You know, it's just coming out a little bit too strong for them, so they kind of adjust the amount of Holy Ghost flow through them. You know, like somebody letting water out of the dam. You see what I'm saying? The damn control. Hopefully nobody misunderstood me when I first said that. Thought I was cussing or something. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, the Lord just laid on my heart and just said, look, you know, just start empowering the leadership that I've raised up among you, the people that have been willing to respond to the anointing. You know, there's a lot of people that have come and gone. They've not been willing to respond to the anointing. I praise God for every one of you. I love you. I love you. Father loves you. He loves you. But then there is a thing about respondents to the anointing, about moving on with God, which then allows us to go ahead and through that obedience to the faith, be put into a place of ready to be sent out. How many people in here tonight, you recognize yourself, that you're doing the work of an evangelist? Can I raise your hand? Would you raise your hand? Come on, every one of you, raise your hand right now. What is wrong with you? Don't start saying, oh, well, I'm not doing it. No, you're doing it. You're doing it. You're doing the work. But if you don't have a boldness about it, come on, man. You're not moving in faith. You're not going to move in the authority of heaven without boldness. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your goodness. Come on, people. Come on. The Lord's going to do His signs and His wonders through people who are willing to take on the life and ministry of Jesus. Everybody else is just in the waiting room. They're in the waiting room. People sit around the waiting room. Waiting. Your wait will never come, and you'll always say you know Jesus, but you'll never have His life, and you'll never do His works, and you'll never walk in His ministry until you say, it's mine, I'm doing it. It's what I do. It's what I do. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. If I was standing in a meeting, and someone said, how many people are doing signs and wonders and miracles? I just raised my hand, both of them. Somebody said, how many people live in the life of Jesus? I raised both hands. Somebody said, how many people have been here moving in the ministry of Jesus? I'd raise both hands. Somebody said, how many evangelists? I'd raise both hands. How many teachers? I'd raise both hands. They say, how many preachers? I'd raise both hands. If they say anything out of the Bible and ask if it's God, I'm raising both hands. I'm like, wondering if anybody else is raising their hand. Am I qualified? You're qualified if you've been born again. If you've been washed in the blood. Hallelujah. 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 People don't realize this, but you know, statistics are showing that the new church norm of attendance, used to be where, you know, during the revival days of the 40s and the 50s, it was like every day. And there was always a normal average of always Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Always. Up until recently. Now the new average, statistical average norm for your average, ordinary, everyday kind of Christian is 80%. It's crazy. It's been said that it's nearly 80% once a month. That's called drifting. That's called backsliding. But you know what? You know, if people aren't engaging in God, go ahead and just do that till you all of a sudden get sin sick, tired of yourself. Because it's another thing, and I'm going to talk about it tonight. I mean, you're going to get a download from heaven. I got a download from heaven. If you don't like the download from heaven that I received from the Father, you take it up with him, because your argument, your quarrel is with him. And I'm telling you right now, one of the things that Father warned Israel about, he says, don't you quarrel with me. Don't you quarrel with me. That's what he said. He said, do not quarrel with me as your fathers did in the wilderness. Do not quarrel with me at the waters of strife. Don't quarrel with me. And he just gives a warning, you know. I would just say, look, Father, you're speaking for the sole purpose of me being able to engage in all the things that you have for me. Listen, all of this is just, it's all so positive. It's all so wonderful. It's all so glorious. It's a bummer when we got to just beg God's people to be healed. And it becomes a fight and a wrestling match to go ahead and just receive what he's asked for you. We want you to just get caught up in the glory. Just let it be a good thing tonight. Hallelujah. Wow, son. Wow. Listen, I'm so blessed with those of you who are being a part of this 21-day fast. We're now entering in this evening, and we entered into the eighth day. Some of you I know are fasting night and day, not taking anything in except for liquids, except for water, rather, just to be more specific. And some people that have joined that are not even in this church, that are joined with us in this fast, that are watching different places. Some of you are fasting 21 days and you're having something in the evenings. Some of you may be fasting at nights, as soon as the sun goes down. Whatever, however you're doing it, you press in, because I'm telling you right now, you know, you're just not moving forward much with God unless you start all of a sudden getting to a place where your own physical body and your own physical needs. Come on. I know so many people, I've heard so many testimonies of people who've been healed of terrible diseases and problems because they went on a fast. And everybody said, you can't fast, you're already sick. They said, no, what? Watch what? I believe in God. I believe what God says. I'm not playing pretend. I'm not living in a falsehood relationship. So many people live in a falsehood relationship, and they don't even know they live in a falsehood relationship until all of a sudden the rubber meets the road and they've got to trust God with their life. Then all of a sudden they recognize, wait a minute, I'm living in a falsehood relationship. I don't really believe he's God. I mean, I don't really believe he's God that's right here willing and able to take care of me. I don't believe he's God like he describes himself, that loves me so much that he's numbered the hairs upon my head, that he's a good God, that he's my healer, my redeemer, my savior, that he's my keeper, that he set me before and behind, that he's aware of my downsittings and my uprisings, that he's formed, tailor-made every little part, even my kidneys, my pancreas. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, I started having pancreas problems regulating my sugar, regulating my insulin. I just go on a fast until I'm healed. Well, that isn't the right thing to do in the minds of men. But when it ain't about men, and this is what I'm going to get at you tonight, and don't sit and listen to me like a bunch of religious people, like people sit and listen to Ezekiel. Because you don't want God's, what Father has to say. You need to rise up and start doing what God said to do. I was just so blessed by everybody went out into the park this weekend. They labored. Hey, the soul that was here from Iran, he's here only for 2 months. Mira Mesa, all the nations are there. You can go to the nations without leaving town. It's radical. Ha! You can go to the nations without leaving town. And all we need is somebody with a little bit of anointing like Cade to get up and preach, and the soul's going to get saved. And it don't matter. And I tell you right now, a little bit of anointing, like anyone. A little bit of anointing, great anointing. I'm just using a little bit of anointing. Because that's all it takes. A little bit of anointing to get people saved. Don't take no big great anointing. Amen. It takes initial salvation anointing to get people saved, become a soul winner. Amen. And that's what Jesus said. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It takes just a little bit of truth and God will baptize you with his glory. Every bit of it. Called the baptism of the Holy Ghost of fire. Zoe, get out there and preach. We'll get Zoe preaching. You got to make a transition from self-consciousness into God consciousness. The more you do, the stronger the flow will come. Hallelujah. Praise God. And that, a lot of that is found in fasting and prayer. You want powerful faith, you're going to have powerful prayer. You want powerful prayer, you're going to have to give yourself to powerful fasting. There is a miraculous supernatural thing that happens in fasting. You listen to me. That you cannot put in your little formula sheet and figure it out. You can't put it in your little ideas of how you logically explain everything. Because I'm going to tell you right now, it's just far beyond anything that you and I have the ability to begin to even consider. God works supernatural things for those people who set themselves aside to seek Him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
My boys were really young when they first fasted. And you know, when they were talking about fasting, you know, I started getting a little bit concerned. You know, they're really young. I started getting a little bit concerned. And then the Spirit of the Lord said to me, "What's your problem?" And I just quit being concerned. I said, "I'm sorry, forgive me. You're God." And I'm starting to think like a man. I don't think like a man. I've been given the Holy Ghost to quit thinking like a man. Quit thinking like a man. And start thinking like a child of God. Start thinking like someone who's bought with a price and translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the dear Son and invested with divine power and authority. And I feel the fire of God. I feel the presence of the Most High. You can be seated. You know, you can be sitting there just totally overwhelmed with hunger, just maybe even just thinking about how hungry you are or how weak you are, and suddenly in that state just make a transition and be in the presence of the Lord like you've never been in His presence, aware of who He is and what He's doing. Suddenly the atmosphere around you, the clouds look different because they're God's clouds. He just formed them, and He's right about just about over top of them, as it were. He's in His high mountain right now. There is a mountain right now. The mountain of the Lord is in the earth right now. Enoch described it in the book of Enoch. Others described it. The mountain of the Lord. Men of God, prophets, and servants of the Lord who received great anointings testified of literally stepping out of this world that you're interfaced with right now and literally stepping over into another world. The same earth. They never left earth. They never left the planet. They didn't get another planet, but it looked like another one. The mountains were higher. The colors were brighter. The beauty and the splendor of it. Everything was pure and clean. And the descriptions that you hear even William Branham give when he would step over there. Amazing stuff. He was a country boy that loved to be out in the woods anyways hunting. So he was very familiar with being up in the North Country, up in Canada, where it's beautiful. You know, we're getting ready to go out and preach in Canada. Hallelujah. We're getting ready to do a 5-day revival in Canada. God's going to moshitakalana mia. He's going to do the things that He's purposed to do in that region of the world. I mean, that's getting right up there, and it's right coastal too. So it's kind of southern Alaska coastal. And we're just believing. We're believing for a great outpouring of God the Holy Ghost. We can't help it that Canada is sandwiched in between. They might as well get in on it too. So they are, you know. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you don't believe these things, then you can never have them. Everybody just come sit down. Come rest your feet. If you don't believe these things, you can't have them. Father wants to set a new norm for you. He wants to set a new expectation for you. And the disciples were unwilling to let God set a new norm for them and a new expectation for them. And so before I get into this too deep, I want you to go in your Bibles with me to Mark chapter 6 and verse 52. Mark chapter 6, verse 52. Listen, I also want to tell you something too, just before I forget, because I constantly forget. A door of a church, I think, is really very important. Can you hear me? Door of church. And reason I think it's important, because it represents the door of Christ Jesus, okay? So, you know, we're building a new building, and I started looking for doors, all your doors, they cost, you get a good set of doors, right? It costs $4,000, right? It's like, wow, you know, Lord, you know, how can we do this? You know, oh, we're always thinking about how to be frugal and this and that and the other. But Lord, I don't want to cut any corners on the door, on the doorway, because I made this doorway to be a 12 by 12 opening. So I want this thing to be big and grandiose. And so I walk into this store and I see this door. I see this huge door and it's like 10 foot tall. And it's all handcrafted. It's amazing. I said, wow, how much does a door like that cost? Oh, $14,000. I said, wow, that is an amazing door. You know, you think, well, you know, you think, mate, here's what you do. Here's how we all think. We think, well, I would like to have that for my house. That's what everybody thinks. Adjust your halo. That's what everybody thinks. And then you kind of hear in the spirit, well, what about my house? I said, yeah, what about your, that's right. Yeah, because we always have to be reminded. We stupid. I'll tell you right now. We are just always just thinking about what about me. It's all what about me. That's just it. I mean, you know, is somebody ever gonna get some big boy britches? I don't know. You know, it's like my wife was in the other room today. She's laughing in there, and I'm like, what are you laughing about? She's listening to the Bible on tape, and of course she got to the part where the disciples are arguing about who's the greatest in the kingdom. I said, that's just us. We are just, you know, when is somebody going to get out of the playpen? I mean, come on. When are we going to get some big boy britches and quit just doing all of our own little thinking? When God wants us to soar in the realms of his divine power and glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I'm getting that $14,000 door.
Yeah.
But. I'm getting it for $6,000. Yeah, this is crazy. Oh, the door costs $14,000, and you know, just, I mean, it's worth it too. It's just amazing. I said, so, how long has it been here? Oh, well, the guy was a very wealthy man who had it built specially for him, and it was delivered here, and then he died. And so the guy who bought it had it all special ordered and special made and everything. He's had it in here for 8 years. 8 years. Wow. He said, yeah, I think he's going to come down on his price. I said, you reckon? Hallelujah. So, you know, I told him, I said, well, we're going to offer him $5,000. And if he comes back at six, we'll take it. And so he came back at $6,000. Got a door. So, you know, just, you know, be a part of it. Let God let you be a part of it. You can be a part of it. If, you know, just let the Lord lay it on your heart and come on. Imagine it, because you don't have the skill to make that. If I had the skill, I'd make it. It is amazing. You'll have to wait and see when you come to the meeting. But Father wants to move us from a whole different realm of thinking. We're stuck. He wants to move us in the realm that he is God.
Amen.
And that everything is his. And anybody who's working for him, he pays the highest wage of any employer on the planet. He pays the highest wage. The people who work for him have the dream jobs. I mean, the people who work for him in missions, they get to travel the world. Hallelujah. Being taken care of by God and had the highest paying jobs of anybody, because their whole salary isn't all just what they receive here right now. It's all the riches that are being put into their account, their savings account. Hallelujah. In the realms of divine and the realms of glory, which the dividends, come on. Every job Father has is a dream job. And of course, he empowers us to work harder than anybody works. I know nobody work harder than I am. I don't know of anybody. Do you know anybody who works harder than I do? I know of no one who works harder than I do. I'd like to meet the person that works harder. I'd like to shake the hand of the person that works harder than me. Because, huh?
Josh was close.
He's standing, he's still eating there. I mean, and it's because Papa gives us divine energy. Now, I know some people who stay up longer than I do, who sleep less than I do, but they don't work harder than I do. And they run wide open, they're constantly on the airplane, they sleep 3 to 4 hours a day. About every month or two, they go away and they hibernate for 48 hours and don't open their eyes. Otherwise, they'd like going, you know, They're going, literally going 21 to 22 hours every day, wide open. True. It's not a fairy tale. Divine energies, divine grace. Hallelujah. Now, listen, people, if you will not let God change your expectation and what you believe is going to happen, you will remain confined and limited to a human realm. You will never know the realms of faith. You will never break out of the shell that you've been living in. You'll never know it. It will always be something you can talk about. It wouldn't be terrible if I was here after all these years and all I could do is talk about how the anointing of the Holy Ghost would work through our lives, Christ Jesus worked through our lives and open up the eyes of the blind, and I've never had the blind eyes open. I'd be like, my goodness, that's a whole nother, you know, dimension of going ahead and calling things which are not as though they were. Because now at some point in time, you're going to have to start doing that which you say God is going to do through you. If I was a preacher saying God's going to do these things through you, he's going to cast out devils through you, he's going to reach the lost through you, and it's never happened in my life. I mean, my goodness, what? I'm a misrepresentation of it all. Because it's not in word, it's in deed. Gospel is in deed. And the only thing that makes the difference between people that have these things and those that don't are some people are just going to lay hold on it. They're just not going to go to sleep till they got it. Amen. They're not going to go to sleep. They're not going to go to sleep. I'm getting no rest of my eyelids. I'm going to lay hold of it. I'm going to have it. Forget about it. I'm not eating food. Whatever. I'm lay hold of it. I'm going to have it. I'm going to go lay hands on enough people till somebody finally, their ears pop open.
Amen.
Come on. Something's going to happen here. I'm gonna start getting down on my knee and begging somebody, would you please give your life to Jesus? So I gotta have somebody in my life who respond to God. And I'm telling you right now, when that kind of desperation comes, you're gonna have a move of God through your life, in your life, and through your life. Father's not interested in lukewarmness. He really isn't. If you need an example of that, if you need an exegesis on that, if you need a declaration, a clear description of that, I'll give it to you some other time, but he's not into lukewarmness. He's not into slothfulness. He's not into laziness. There's nothing lazy about the kingdom of God. There's nothing lazy about the people of God. The only people that can have what Father has to give is those who are hungry and thirsty for it. In other words, their hunger and thirst cannot describe a greater passion. Huh? Again, right now you don't feel it, right? Because you passed the date. You passed the dateline, right? You don't feel it. You're a little weak, right? Comes on. I know it comes on every once in a while. It comes in surges. And you can feel your muscles feel like they're being eaten away, but they're not. That's all a lie. It comes in surges. But there'll come a moment in time where you get hungry. I love the fast where, and afterwards he was hungry. But those don't really come very often. I had one last year. It's just divine. It was divine. And afterward I was hungry. But that passion of hunger, we all know it. You miss the meal. You know what I'm talking about, right? I need to really break that down for you. Water especially. Yes. Especially at the beginning of a fast, how thirsty that you get. And, that's a passion that God is describing to us in every way he possibly can. Those are the people who are going to begin now to be in a place where they can receive what he wants to give. It's a yielded state towards him. And it's not just a yielded state to saying, Lord, I passionately want these things, but it's really a passionately, I want these things, and knowing that they're there for you, because whatever he's done for anybody else, he will do it for you, because he's right. No respecter of person.
Yes, sir.
He's given all these things that he's described to us in the Word simply to whet our appetite for him, to cause us to come after him, to seek him. And when you're busy seeking God, Satan can't play his demonic games anymore. Come on over into the purity. You'll see a whole lot of things a lot differently. You'll go, wow. Come on over in this place. Because then you're going to go, wow, Pastor, you were seeing all of this and you were still being patient and long-suffering? Yeah, it's divine grace. It's Father's patience and long-suffering because he sees a whole lot more at a glance. He sees a whole lot more. And he does not just give in a glance. His eyelids try. Literally, he squints to see if there's anybody among the sons of men who are really willing to be real with him and walk with him. Who are willing to really, 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 truly willing to believe him and put him to the test, as it were. Elijah was one of those guys. You know, the encounters that Moses had made him one of those guys. I think Moses was always one of those guys. He was always a passionate guy. But I want you to look at a verse of Scripture that people think that Jesus was being way too hard on his disciples. Do you know that there's a lot of folks that believe that Jesus was way too harsh of a minister? Yeah, I know it's true. And they're trying to find ways to dilute it because he was intense. He was intense. You faithless and adulterous generation, how long do I have to put up with you? It's pretty harsh. I never came into the meeting and said, faithless, adulterous. Not like that, but I have come in the spirit of Jesus dealing with the same kind of attitudes and problems and issues. And most of you probably did exactly what the disciples did. You ducked. And everything got really quiet in here. And it was hard to feel the presence of the Lord. Oh, but what happens when you grow and mature in God and He can rebuke you and you go, yes, Lord, yes. And nothing changes. You're not self-preservation anymore. You don't run and hide in shame. You don't duck and run. Huh? You don't come up with all the excuses to try to legitimize your unbelief and disobedience. Do you know that we do that? Did you know that? We do that till we grow up just a little bit. We're legitimizing our unbelief and disobedience, and there is no legitimizing it. But we try. Then suddenly we begin to grow up and go, no, 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 no. Oh, God, it's just ugly bad, ain't it? It is ugly bad. It's like Anna getting caught with Naomi's hair on the floor and a terrible haircut. I mean, she, you know, when they face messaged me and I saw her and I just started buzzing up laughing because it was hysterical. There's nothing they can do. It's the shame. There's no explanation. There's no getting out of it. Hair was once on her head. Now it's on the floor and it's ugly. And there's nothing pretty about it. And Anna says, I was only going to do it once. There we go. Legitimizing it. Open your Bibles to Mark chapter 6. And let's listen to the harsh ministry of Jesus, which I delight in. His rebukes are a help to me because I so want what He has.
Yes.
I so want what He has to offer. I so want the reality. I'm so done with falsehood and fantasy and the plasticness of men's life, the shallowness of their commitments. The fleetingness of men's love and friendship. Or in everything else. Because everybody, including myself. I want God. I want what He has. I want to lay hold on Him. And He's trying to help us. He's trying to work with us. He says, listen, just don't think that way anymore. Think this way. And you're no longer going to be living under those problems, those issues. But we don't think, He does everything He possibly can do to get us to think different. And there we are, retreating back to the same old thinking. He says, please, I don't want you to speak that way. If you'll just speak this way, you can have my life. You can function in all this goodness. You can function in all of these blessings that I've given for you. And what are we doing? We're right back to with oral dysentery, as one person described it. I thought it was very fitting. And you know, if you've had a stomach flu lately, you know, that kind of really speaks volumes. Because you can remember. You know what I'm saying? It's just it. It's just speaking our own things over ourselves, not God's things. He wants us to agree with Him. He wants us to speak His word. He wants us to proclaim what He said. He wants the weak to say, I'm strong. But the weak don't say, I'm strong. They say, I'm weak. He wants the sick to say, I'm not sick. But the sick don't want to say, I'm not sick.
I'm looking for somebody. Can't you feel a little sorry for me? I haven't been around my mom for a couple of months. And she's the only one who empathizes.
No. Father wants to deliver you from that, make you feel good rather than have somebody just sit there and just empathize. Say, poor you. We love you so much. Oh, you, poor you.
What do you want? Somebody sympathize with you, say, poor you. Oh, we love you so much. Can I get you anything, darling? Oh, bless your heart. Or would you like to be completely free of it? And so the reality of it is this is the Lord trying to train his disciples. And he's going, you know, I'm just like, oh, my goodness. I was like, oh, brother, you know, what are we going to do now? This is the best. This is what I got to work with. You know, when you know, there's a time, you know, it's like, Lord, what have you given me to work with? He's like, think about what I had to work with. Huh? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And if you're insulted by that, shame on you. We just found out where you're living, Mr. Pride. Huh? Mr. Haughty, Mr. Arrogant, Mr. I'm It, Mr. Ego. You know, give me a break. Get into the program over here. Understand who you are so the Lord can change you.
Amen.
You know, and he's changed us by the radical conversion of the new birth, but he wants to change us also in behavior through maturity, okay? I mean, I forget that Naomi is 2 years old because she's so bright and so perceptive. I mean, she walks into the house and she sees a picture that has an abstract drawing of a cross that is almost impossible for anybody to discern. And she goes, oh, there's the cross. I mean, I just love that. And, you know, I forget that she's 2 years old. She's 2 years old. And I think she's much older. And then I got to remind myself, well, she's only 2 years old, man. I mean, give her a break. You know, she's not five. She acts like she's five a lot of times. She's two. Give her a break. But you know what? There's absolutely certainty that she's going to be different, that she's going to change by the time she's 15 years old. And if she didn't, we're going to think about this thing in reverse. Right now we're going, well, she's really, really bright. But then we're going to be going, we need a miracle over here. Because she's 15, she acts like she's 2 or 3 or something. Huh? So there's a change there, and I need you to understand it. I want you to understand something. You're never going to get this unless you recognize that the first day that you believed upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and allowed the power of God to change you, at that moment in time, you could never become more righteous. You could never become more acceptable to God. Never. Not in a billion years from now, because you get, at that moment in time, you've got to step into his life and receive the righteousness of God, his righteousness. And people are always messed up trying to get themselves more right. Listen, I want you to know that is absolutely law and works and has nothing to do with grace. It's fallen from grace. I get to always live in this place of that I'm holy and acceptable to God, that I can't be more righteous. I'm everything that he demands me to be because I put my trust in Jesus. And if I fall and if I fail and if I sin, then I can come to him and I can repent and I can confess it and I can get washed. And I'm going to tell you right now, when you begin to live in that, there is a brokenness and a humility that takes hold of you, that you are absolutely transparent before God and transparent before man, and nobody corrects you and get a bad attitude out of you. They get out of you rather someone who's meek and lowly and submitted to God, because it's a relationship issue. It's a relationship issue. People are always retaliating. You know, they want to argue. They want to recoil. They want to act like they've been hurt or offended. They do not really know the living God. They really do not know. They do not have a vital relationship with him. They don't understand forgiveness. They don't understand the level of mercy that they've already received. I want you to consider this with me. God's done great things for us. I mean, you think about what he did for us. You think about what he did for us when he gave to us this life in Christ Jesus, sparing not his own son. That needs to set a precedence for you to expect what he's going to do tomorrow. Unfortunately, it doesn't in people's life. It doesn't set a precedence for them. They're always wanting God to constantly prove his love, prove your love, prove your love. You don't really love me. You don't prove your love. Man, I'm telling you right now, if I had to live, if my wife would treat me like that, I'd like, Lord, I don't know what I would have done. He'd have given me grace, but that would have been hell on earth. Having to constantly prove my love. But God's people constantly, in many respects, are trying to get Father to continually prove his love. Prove it again. Prove it again. Prove it again. Well, you went through the Red Sea. Is that not enough? No, prove it again. Well, you got manna. Is that not enough? Falling from? No, prove it again. Well, you have a cloud of glory, fire by night, and a cloud by day. No, that's not enough. Prove it again. We don't really believe you're in our midst. We don't really believe
that you're here. We're thirsty. Give us water. The waters of Marah. The waters, rather, not the bitter waters, but the waters of strife. Meriah, the waters of strife. And it's the waters of quarrel. Quarreling with who? Quarreling with God. Tempting him. And why was that? We understand from the Old Testament, we also understand from Hebrews chapter 3 and 4, it's because their hearts were hardened against God. And, you know, there are many different ways to describe hardened hearts, and there's different dimensions of hardened hearts. There's hearts that are hardened because of hate. There's hearts that are hardened because of arrogance and pride. There's hearts that are hardened because of sin. Huh? And there's hearts that are hardened because of unbelief. I don't want to change my mindset. And this particular verse of scripture here in Mark chapter 6, verse 52, highlights hardened hearts because of unbelief. And so let's just look at verse 7. They're not willing to let the precedents that God has set change their attitude. Look at this. Just look here with me in Mark chapter 6 and start at verse 50. And of course, before I read this, in case some of you don't know, let me just set the scenario for you, okay? The Lord Jesus has just taken 7 loaves and 2 fishes, and he has, in the hands of his disciples and by the hands of his disciples, bent the universe. He bent the universe. He changed the laws that govern everything that exists. And from that, he then began to create. And 5,000, not counting men and women, were fed. And then he took up 12 basketfuls after that. Now, Father, Christ Jesus is thinking, we got it done. Everybody has now stepped out of the realm of the earthly, out of the realm of the predictable, out of the realm of the everyday and the ordinary, and now have stepped into the realm of the heavenly and realized, wait a minute, there's nothing impossible here now.
Amen.
So Jesus sends them now, he sends them across the lake. The lake is probably at that point in time some more than 5 or 6 miles. I think at the widest spot, I think the lake is, if my memory serves me correctly, around 11 to 13 miles. This place where they're sitting, he sent them across 5 to 6 miles. They're rowing for about 9 hours and they're getting no headway. They're making no headway. Bless their hearts, they're obedient. I'm telling you, it's true. It's true. It is true. We're not the brightest bunch. We're not the brightest bunch. Okay? We aren't. But Father would like to give us his wisdom, his knowledge, his understanding. Huh? They didn't realize that they were vested with the power to immediately be over there. They didn't realize that they were vested with, they're getting ready to discover something. They did not realize that they had been already vested with the power to say to the wind and the wave, stop. So they could have done that. Or they could have actually been translated across the lake. They've been vested with the power. The universe had been bidding people with them. They are going in the word of the eternal God. Stop and think for a minute. They have been commissioned by the Almighty God to go across the lake, and they've just stepped out of the greatest supernatural display of the power of God that has ever been seen and witnessed by the eyes of men. And it happened through their own hand. They weren't sitting around watching Jesus take and divide all the bread and do it all himself. He took and divided it to them, and they watched as their own hands worked the miracle, as their own hands were involved in the miracle, and the bread stacked high, you know, stacked up high, and the fish stacked up high, and it's just this supernatural event taking place. And believe me, I have been privileged to be in supernatural events, and there is a manifest presence of God that will make you absolutely loopy. Drunk in the, as we say in the Holy Ghost, just wow. I mean, the most, it will excite the most emotional response of ecstasy and of excitement. I mean, it's way better than any ride at Six Flags. It goes way beyond anything you've ever done that has called you to go wow. I mean, I wish we could start taking pictures of people in church like they do, you know, at Six Flags when you're getting ready to do the drop. But you're really encountering more of that which was available for you.
But you can't be walking around in expectation that things are going to be as they've always been. It's just always been this way. We're all fishermen. We know the water. We know the ways. Here we are. We're stuck. We're dying. Wait a minute. Time out. There was nobody in the boat could say, hey, do you think we got some power here? You think we got some supernatural assistance here? We've been sinned by the word of God Almighty. Did you see what just happened? Did you see what we just did? 5,000. It's probably 15,000. Let's say there's 15. It's just men, not counting women and children. That's just like one per family. It was more than that. 15,000 people. Did you see what we just did? Come on, think about it, people. Think about it. Think about it. Oh, mighty God. Oh, that we could break the limitations and the confinement of our own perception and begin to see what God is actually doing. I promise you, we will step over into a place of receptivity and agreement with God and begin to be His witnesses and begin to be those heirs that He's ordained us to be. It's so true. Jesus sees him toiling. He comes down walking on the water far off. They go, they're crying out, oh, was bad enough. Now there's some kind of phantom coming towards us. Some kind of devil. This is crazy. Jesus says, fear not, guys. Come on, relax. It's me. He gets into the boat. He rebukes the wind and the wave. And immediately they're on the other side of the shore. Immediately they were translated. Wow! They're thinking, wow! And they were sore astonished. And Jesus was looking, you gotta be kidding me. You're still amazed? This should be normal by now. This should have been your expectation by now. I've already sent the president. Don't you get it? Can't you consider what's been happening around you? Man, you in the supernatural power of the Almighty God. You are in the midst of the one who created heaven and earth where nothing is impossible. Can't you get it? So he says, this verse of scripture, now that you know his frustration, he says this. Let me find it here. He says this concerning them. And I think it's said more radically in another verse of Scripture. But listen to this. Verse 51. And he went up into them, into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed, and they shouldn't have been. Their expectation of what should be happening around Jesus has still not changed since he first met them. They're still expecting the carnal, the natural, the ordinary, the everyday. They were sore amazed, and this is what just sent Jesus over the edge. They were sore amazed about the miraculous. And having in comparison to what he just did, this is hardly nothing. They were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure. And wondered. That's a very important verse of scripture. They were sore amazed beyond themselves and wondered. What is that saying? Just nothing but doubt and unbelief. We still don't know who we're hanging around. We still aren't certain that this is going on. Or somebody wake me up from this dream. It's an amazing dream, but it can't be true. And so what the Lord Jesus says and what Mark says concerning what he had said and concerning their condition, he said, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. Always Jesus comes, and if we spend some time just going through all these various verses of Scripture, we'll see Jesus saying, have you yet still hardened your heart? Let's go look at it. In fact, we can at least do one out of the many, because it's in the very next chapter. And you know, let's see. Jesus is talking about the leaven of the scribes and the Pharisees. Help me find it. I know it's right here in chapter It's 8:17. And 8:17, it also says that it speaks of their hearts being heard in chapter 7. Let's just go to this one here right now. And Jesus, he says to them, he charged them, saying, verse 15, chapter 8, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, oh no, it's because we've not brought any bread. He said, did you make sure, you know, they're thinking, he's talking about bread. He's wondering if we got enough food to eat. And it's amazing. And when Jesus, brilliant. And when Jesus knew it, he said to them, why reason you, because of you have no bread? Perceive ye not yet, neither understand? Have your hearts you yet hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? Having ears, do you not hear? Don't you remember? He's trying to help bring them out of a natural realm into a supernatural realm. You know, God dealt with Israel over and over and over again till finally, in the midst of him sending Isaiah, you know, we look at the beauty of Isaiah chapter 6 and we see the encounter that Isaiah had with the Almighty God. But there's also something else going on in Isaiah chapter 6. He said, I'm going to send you a people who hearing they cannot hear and seeing they cannot perceive. Whose hearts they have hardened, lest they should understand and be converted. And then he repeats that in Matthew chapter 8, a place where the people of God are just unwilling. They're bent on a human existence. They're bent on their own arm of flesh. They're bent on their own predictable models. They're unwilling to walk with God in the realms of the Spirit, which is another way of saying willing to walk with God in the realms of the supernatural. If you're going to walk with God, you're going to have to learn that he has a divine provision, that he has a divine perfection, that he has a divine protection, that he has a divine life that you and I are supposed to be interacting with out of a divine relationship.
Amen.
We got to leave these things of condemnation and shame and doubt and all these, you know, various different attitudes that's going to cause us being thirsty and hungry for the things that are in the world and unbelieving concerning what he's going to do. Well, I'm not sure God's going to do it, but I'm pretty certain that the lawyer can help. I'm not sure that God's going to do it, but I'm pretty certain the doctor can help. And on and on. Is there anyone going to press through and begin to let all that God has done set the precedence for what we believe he's going to do? Really, what Jesus is dealing with in the hardness of their heart is that they've seen the supernatural. They've seen one miracle provision, one mighty act after another. And of course, the dividing of the loaves and the fishes being the biggest act ever, and their hands being participative in it. And it should have changed the whole dynamic of what they're expecting tomorrow. Same situation with Israel. Here they got one miracle after another, but it doesn't change the expectation of what they believe is going to happen tomorrow. As soon as the phone rings, they know it's bad news. It's got to be bad news. Oh, they're telling me that my son's dead. They're telling me my daughter just died. They're telling me that they're calling in our note. They're telling me that I'm going to get arrested. I mean, every fearful thing. It happens with people. They're always predicting that somehow they're going to be in crisis. Somehow they're going to be in judgment. Somehow, you know, they're going to be in disaster. You should not have had an experience with God that caused you to predict such an outcome for the future. You should have had enough experience with God at this point to realize he's going to protect you, that he's going to keep you, that he's going to provide for you according to his riches and glory, that you can trust him with your body and you can trust him with your children.
Amen.
You're saying you can trust him with your eternal soul? How do you know that Jesus isn't a liar? How do you know he's not a deceiver? How do you know you're not on the wrong trail? How do you know you're not believing the wrong thing? How do you know the Jews aren't right? How do you know the Hindus aren't right? How about you being wrong? How about maybe the Mormons are right and we're all a bunch of infidels? There's some place you got to trust God here. Hello? Hello, someplace. He's got to be able to bring you to trust him with your eternal soul, but you can't trust him with your body. Give me a break. You got some wire crossed up in there. Hallelujah. We're going to get it fixed in Jesus' name. Father wants you to see. He wants you to be able to perceive what's going to take place. He wants you to begin to move in faith based upon who he is, what he describes himself to be. His word is the power and the authority that framed the ages. He's given to us his word so that you and I would start speaking it, would start meditating on it. That would be our thoughts. And out of that would come the richness of faith and the predictability of what God is going to do. And out of that would come would come an experience with him, a relationship with him, where God every day is there in the midst of our lives, and we see over and over again his divine provision, his divine protection. We see his love, his care, his keeping power. We get to experience the supernatural realms of this relationship that we have with him. And it should cause us to know, listen, everything, I'm going to sleep tonight. Everything's going to be fine. I cast all my cares upon him. I'm not worried about anything. Hey, Father, here, take all this. Good night. Hey, Father, take all this. And then I'm just going to walk in the light that sees in the light and just know that he's going to, everything's going to be more than just fine.
Amen.
Everything's going to be supernatural.
Amen.
If you look with me in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, there's a very disturbing, verse of scripture there. And it said, if our gospel be hid. And I really got, everybody, pretty much everybody knows about this one, and they apply it only to the lost, and it's rightfully so. It should only be applied to the lost. Sin should only be applied to the lost. Doubt should only be applied to the lost. Unbelief should be only applied to the lost. Powerlessness should only be applied to the lost. Not walking a supernatural life, living in the Spirit as God is in the Spirit, should only be applied to the lost. But unfortunately, we can't. Because too many of God's people have got a whole lot of that going on in their life. And the scripture says, if our gospel be hid, is it verse 4? Verse 3, said, if our gospel be hid, it's hid from those whom the God of this world has blinded. Now listen, let's talk about for just a moment, let's just consider the gospel, because the gospel is the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me. Yes. To preach good news to the poor, and that good news starts off with everything that is contrary to God, that is an offense to God, that is separated from God, I'm going to destroy it. And it's going to cease to exist, and I'm going to make you a new creation. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Isn't it good news that God doesn't come with a knife to kill you?
Yes.
Huh? He comes with his glory to make you new.
Hallelujah.
And then after you get new, he tells you you're dead. You died.
Yeah, that's right.
It's great. You get to live before he gives you the bad news. And then it's not bad news. It's like the old thing, the old way, the former life, the body of sickness, the body of sin, the body of disease, the body of under the law of sin and death. It doesn't exist anymore.
Amen.
It's done away. And it got done away. It was done away in the beauty and the splendor of the miracle of the new creation when you was born again. This is the gospel. This is our starting place. And now you're not flesh anymore to live like a man. That which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of a man is like a man, to live as a man, to do what men do. He said, no. You're born in the Spirit, to live in the Spirit, and God is Spirit, so that you can worship Him, so that you can interact with Him, so that you can move with Him. Listen, it's about time God has some people on the earth that look like the sons of God. Because right now we know that He has sent forth this wonderful grace into our lives, and we are the seed, born of an incorruptible seed, the seed that is represented as wheat, the sons of God. We're not the tares that the wicked one sowed, which are the sons of the devil, children of the devil. We are walking around in His world, and we should be shining as lights. We should be moving in the life and ministry of Jesus, because there is no other model of that which pleases Father. So then if we're not, then we've got to deal with ourselves. And this is the biggest problem. Because you start trying to say, listen, you got to deal with yourself. And people are going, why? you can lay it out. And all the extreme examples. I heard a preacher laying it out, whom I love. And, he's a son to me. And he's like laying it out, and he got so extreme with it that I actually had to call him up and say, because you're so passionate about saying, wait a minute, come on, people, hold up. What you sitting there looking at me like another human being for? When you're supposed to be moving in the life and ministry of Jesus, when you're supposed to be walking in the supernatural realm, when you're supposed to be believing God for things more than what, look, come on. If a man can do it, If a man and a human being can do it, what can a person who's anointed of God and filled with the Spirit do? Okay, if the president's been set that Bill Gates would make all the money, he's got a mother, he's got a father, he's a human being. Did it all in the human realm. Somebody said, oh, Satan helped him. So that is supposed to now make him an isolated case of certain, you know, privileges that no one else can access. Hold up, let me with you work on your theology for a minute. Right. How God is much greater in power than Satan. If Satan can give that to somebody, what do you think God can do? Give me a break.
Come on.
It's just that we're stuck. We're stuck in our own perceptions, in our own worlds, in our own limitations, which our mind imposes upon us. Mind-blinding spirits. If our gospel be hid, it's hid from those whom the God of this world has blinded their minds. Mind-blinding spirits. I still can't see that I actually was the one who took those loaves and with my hands I broke off that bread and it kept breaking off. In fact, as I broke off pieces, the pieces were bigger than what I was breaking it off of. And it didn't stop there. To take out 12 basketfuls, somebody else had to get in on that too. Because they would have stopped as soon as the last hand was out. Right? So somebody had to keep breaking the bread for there to be all that leftovers. And people gorged themselves that day. No one was fasting. And it's all about Jesus' love and compassion with the people. They want to send them away hungry. Lest they faint in the way. He's very mindful of our condition and our state. He loves us so much. He's already had to deal with us. He had to deal with 12 representatives of us. And before that, he had 30 years of observation going. Staying pretty quiet about it all, but going, oh my goodness. These people are sorely in need of redemption. Of course, he already knew it. Come on, people, let's go ahead and step into redemption. Yes. Let's go ahead and step in redemption. Yes, when you were redeemed, you no longer have a defiled conscience. People can never be right because they have no redemption. All the other religions cannot make people right because there is no moment of redemption. Christians, God's people, are supposed to have a moment of redemption, and they still have a defiled conscience trying to get right with God. You're supposed to have redemption. Where you redeemed, you're bought back, you're his, you belong to him, you're like, I belong to God. We are the people of God, and he is our Lord. And you get excited about that, man. I tell you, there's been more than one day that I woke up singing that song. That is a great way to a great way to wake up. My voice shalt thou hear in the morning. And that is a great way for the Lord to be able to hear your voice in the morning. And I'm going to tell you right now, until you get in a relationship, you just think you're just singing in the air, you're listening to your voice, you're going, oh, my Bob brought us a little off or whatever. No, all of a sudden, it doesn't even matter. You in another realm, man. You in God. You're like, you're worshiping God. He's sitting there or standing there just soaking it in. I play the recorder for him. No, I do. He's there listening. I play the flute for him. I play the guitar for him. I sing for him. I enjoy ministering to him, ministering to his presence. It changes the whole dynamics of your life. Yes. Suddenly you begin to step into all of his provision. And I haven't stepped into all of his provision, but I'm going after it. One of the things I loved about Eddie Boy, with all of his success, he's like, well, I'm so passionate, I'm so hungry to be used by God, I'm so hungry, just take it to another place. I hear him just talking about this. He said, I want my plane to land and everybody for 10 kilometers to be immediately healed as soon as my wheels touch on the ground. I mean, just like taking it to another place. I'm so hungry, I'm so thirsty to grab. This is, praise God for a model, because what we've seen a lot of times is, first of all, we haven't really seen much of a model. And then we get a model. And it's like people get a little bit more of anointing, a little bit more of a display of the power and the presence and the manifest glory of God in their lives than everybody else. Suddenly now they're super normal. They're above average. And so they become, somebody is specially anointed. And then they stop pursuing. They're no longer desperate, hungry, passionate. I got to have these things in God. I've got to lay hold on the realms of all that He's provided for me. And that growth of faith, that increase of faith, is supposed to be built on the experience that I've just had. The experience that I've had all along through this way. God, look, I look at where God has brought me from the day that I called upon His name and I was washed in the blood and made a new creation, and the strongholds of everything that I had gone through was broken off of me. I think of where He's brought me from that day to this day, and I'm in great expectation. Watch what He's going to do with me from here over the next 10 years. Whoa, whoa! Because I'm telling you right now, you know, I was thinking about the difference between velocity today and acceleration. You know, an acceleration is increases in velocity. I mean, I'm telling you right now, forget about velocity. That's almost like sustaining, you know, just sustaining, you know. That's almost like a predictable model. Let's go to some acceleration. That's like an unpredictable model, right? My goodness, I feel acceleration.
Amen.
I feel acceleration in God. Boom, knocks you all the way back. It glues you to your chair. Whoa! Think about this, dear people. Father has this for us. I mean, it becomes something so real. It's so real that it does indeed affect your emotions. Some people have these crazy fictional movies on television, in many respects more real than God, because they have a greater emotional response to those events than they do God. Why? Because they are so dependent upon their sense realm. They only feed their sense realm. They only live by their sense realm. And so now that they get to see and they get to hear, and you know, that which is going on being betrayed in a movie, and so it takes them, it captures them, and then they respond to this crazy. It's just like, you know, Anne doesn't watch TV. She can't watch TV. If she watches TV, she gets horrified, and we all have to tell her. We have to say, honey, it's not real. She's like, it's not real, baby. She's like, it's just fake. It's fake. It's like, fake. Here, watch this. I'll turn it off. Turn it off. It's fake. None of this is happening. She looks at it like it's just happening, like somebody just got hurt. She can't take it. Good. I'm praise God. That's good. She should stay that way. She can't take it. But it's not real. Yet many people, you, me, we react to it as though it is. Because we allow ourselves to be brought into a lie, to live vicariously in a realm that really we respond to more than actually God. Why? Because we've not allowed our senses of the Spirit, the realms of the Spirit. We've just been willing to live like a human being and rely upon those senses of the sight and the smell and the hearing and the touch and the predictable things of what we think the laws of life are dictated by. Oh, I gotta go get money so I can buy bread. We think it's all based upon those things which we can provide by our own hand. No, God's got a whole nother set of rules over here, a whole nother set of laws that you never get to participate with until you start allowing the spiritual senses to be developed and to come alive, so that you begin to perceive and understand something that right now, by and large, you cannot see. Unless God touches you. Amen. And He's going to touch you because you seek Him.
Yes.
Because you're hungry for Him.
Amen.
I promise you, you're going to see so many more things than you've ever seen in your life.
Amen.
In the Spirit. I promise you, Papa's going to use you far beyond in the ability to worship Him and hear the sounds of heaven.
Amen.
And just flow.
Yeah.
In the realms of glory.
Amen.
Not be under any pressure or concern about what anybody thinks, because it's just you playing for Him, singing for Him. I'm ministering to Him. He's the lover of my soul. He's the light and the life of my salvation. To know Him is more important to me than to even exist. Your loving kindness is better than life to me. To know You, to understand who You are, it's more important than to even exist. That takes you to another level of hunger and thirsting, and a whole other place of like, wait, hold up. This isn't just, you know, going to church and making sure that everybody smiles at me and likes me and shakes my hand properly. Or I hear the songs that I want to hear sung, and I hear the sermons that I want to hear read. And this is read. Because when you're in that state, you want to hear nothing of the Spirit. You want to hear that only which the flesh of man's intellect and wisdom, the humanity realm, is what I talk, when I'm saying flesh, that's what I'm talking about. That which is born of flesh. Jesus was manifested in the flesh. He bore our sins in his own body, in the flesh. Hallelujah. He suffered in the flesh, that kind of flesh, in a human earthly body. But he was not subject to a human earthly realm. He lived in heaven.
Amen.
He always set Father before him and at his right hand. And tonight I'm just pleading with you by the Spirit of the living God. Just follow up of this morning. If you weren't in this morning's meeting, this is the second part of this morning's meeting. You need to get this morning's meeting. You need to get into it before, you know, too long. Don't let the week go by and say, oh yeah, you know, I really need to listen to Sunday morning meeting. If you're doing ministry in this church, I bless you. I praise God for you. Thank you. I'm going to tell you right now, the ministry to those kids is more important than anything I can think of.
Amen.
And I'm so blessed by it, but you need to be fed. You need to be built up. You cannot miss out on what God's doing. He's laying a foundation for the year so that I can function accurately, and you can function accurately and speak on his behalf accurately in the year 2017, a year he's designed for his own glory and his own divine purposes. And I want to understand what his divine glory and purposes are in this year, and not what my own ambitions and what my own visions are in this year, what man dictates, what the history has imposed upon me to believe is going to happen in this year, my predictable models. I don't want nothing to do with it. Someplace and sometime I'm going to bring an end to that influence in my life. And I'm not going to allow it to blind my mind no more.
Amen.
Really, people, tell you the truth. According to the Word of God, the battle is in the mind. It really isn't anywhere else. And, praise God, you got some part of the gospel, kid. Some part of the gospel is not hidden from you. You are willing or able to recognize that Jesus is Lord, and you have some kind of interaction with him, but you don't know him enough to overcome sin yet. The Lord wants to deal with that. You don't know him enough to live in healing yet. He wants to help you with that.
Amen.
You don't know him enough to be able to move in faith to represent him. He wants to deal with that. He wants to help you with that.
Amen.
He wants to cure that.
Amen.
He wants to cure that.
Yeah.
Do you want to cure that? That's the issue. Because a lot of people say, yeah, Lord, have at it. You know where I live. You got my address. No, that ain't gonna. That's not kind of. That's plastic, fake, not real. Father wants something to do with it. He wants truth. He's given to us his Spirit so that we can know him and be real with him. Because man outside of being born again is fake, is false, is under deception, is full of a lie, is as fickle and as changing as any devil in hell. They're not to be counted on, they're not to be trusted. They're only going to use you as a step to get to where they're going. They're going to walk all over you. Period. The state of sinful man. There is no truth. God's people, they're always going to be interceding for you. They're always going to be talking good and lovely of you. And even you. Everybody, and the people that are, they're having the hardest time, they're going to be interceding. They're going to be praying, oh God, I'm just bringing. I tell you, the people in this church that are the weakest and in the greater need, you get more of my prayer attention. Because I'm going, God, what do we got to do with this person? What? What is it going to take? Father, break off the yoke. I just need to go to prayer. I go to prayer. I go to interceding. What is it going to take? What is it going to take, Lord? What's it going to take? For them to no longer be in bondage. To walk around as a Christian that is sick and diseased, you're profaning his name. You're the most invalid ministry of Jesus that exists in his church. If I was sick and diseased, nobody would know it. Because I'm not going to profane his name.
Amen.
Huh? And I'm telling you right now, I lay hold on him and I get healed. Because I tell you right now, there is no, listen, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us from them all.
Amen.
All of them.
Amen.
I tell you right now, as many things has hit my life as it has hit anybody else, and maybe more. It's just that I found a relationship with the Lord that gets me healed every time. It gets me delivered every time. Come on now. God's not a respecter of persons. It's just that I believe who he is. I've set my expectation on the future based upon everything that his words describe concerning who he is. I believe he's true. I believe he's real. He's my God. I've made him my God. I talk to him like my God. One of the things that I really like watching about a couple of new ministries that I'm looking at is where they're just extolling the Lord, and they just talk about who higher than the highest, wiser than the wisest. It's really not for fathers, for them. If you begin to do that, suddenly it begins to impact the way you think. It begins to impact your heart. Yes. According to man, the way a man thinks, so is his heart. Yes. The heart is just like the seed of the thought and the thinking and the understanding, and Father wants that to be in every way right. He's made it right, and he wants it to stay right. But the heart goes along and agrees with all kinds of things that are not true and violates God's way and violates God's law and violates the things of the Spirit because they've exalted their own perceptions and understanding above the knowledge of God. And didn't even mean to and didn't even know it. If they would have been under authority, if they would have honored the people of God that were over them, they would have never done it, or they wouldn't have done it long, because they would have come under the correction and they'd have recognized, I'm thinking wrong, I'm acting wrong, I'm living by my own perceptions, and thus I have no divine perceptions. Why don't I have divine perceptions? Living by my own perceptions. Why don't I have divine sense? Because I rely on my own sense. What happens when you stop? I'm not relying on my own sense anymore. I'm not relying on my own perceptions anymore. God, I'm going to hear your voice. It's going to require some patience. It's going to require you and I to ratchet back on all of our decision making. Huh? It's going to demand of us an obedience. It's going to demand of us a trust that risk our lives, because the Lord's going to test us. He's going to say, "Okay." Now you think that He doesn't go too hard too quickly. If you've never been asked by the Lord to lay down your life, where you're risking your life, you may be killed. It's just simply He's preparing you for that day. If the Lord's never, you know, the Lord challenges people all the time. Listen, I'll heal you, but you got to trust me. But between you being healed and trusting God, there's a possibility of dying. In trusting God, between you trusting God and being healed or being provided for, there's the risk of dying. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
There's a risk of something going amiss. Going awry. Consequences. Then you got all these people that come around you and say, "Oh, if you don't do such and such a thing, it's going to be such and such. It's going to be terrible. Oh, and if you wait too long, it's going to be even worse. Oh, you got to make a decision now, because I'm telling you right now, the reaper's coming to reap." The mind battle. Oh. Suddenly I realize all of these things that are coming at me from my own predictable models, from the own natural expectation, from my own sense of self-preservation. See, if I don't know my enemies, if I don't know my foe, how am I ever going to be able to stand against them and be guarded against them? I'm just going to let them run over me, because I don't recognize them as an alien. I don't recognize them as an invader. I don't recognize them as a threat to my life. I accept them as normal and as friendly. But suddenly I recognize, wait a minute, hold up. Father wants me to move into his thoughts. I can't have my thoughts and move into his thoughts. Father wants me to see things that I can't see. If I'm relying upon what I can't see, I can't come over into this new perception. Somehow I've got to be able to move past those things that I believe about the way things work and start saying, "Yes, Lord, this is how it works. You take 7 loaves and 2 fishes and feed 15,000 people. You walk on the water, no problem. You walk on the water, you get in the boat, immediately everything is calm and we're translated on shore." Can you imagine? The boat is docked. I promise you, it wasn't just sitting floating in the water. It was docked. And they're all sitting there. You get verse 51? Astonished beyond measure. What just happened? Because they considered not yesterday. They didn't consider the miracle yesterday. It was even more glorious and more spectacular than Jesus stepping in the boat, immediately a great calm, and you're sitting on shore. Immediately, two things happen instantaneously. And the Lord's just like, "You guys are so hard-hearted. You've hardened your heart against what I'm here to do, what I've displayed to you, what I've showed you, just as your fathers did in the wilderness. They did the same thing. The hardness of their heart was different than the hardness of Pharaoh's heart. It's important to look at it. Say, Lord, is my heart hardened? Lord, have I been unwilling to be yielded to you? Because this is the opposite of yieldedness. I want to learn yieldedness. I want to learn sensitivity. I don't want to be isolated by my own realm of what I believe is going to happen. Oh, don't tell me, Jesus, I've been a fisherman all my life. You've been up there in Nazareth doing carpentry. Hey, same thing. No difference. Just a little, one's a little more vocal and overt than the other. Same unbelief. Same attitudes. Same mind thinking. Same perception. I know more than you do. Here's the way it's going to happen, and we do it every day in our life, and we are up against the whole counsel of God, the whole Word of God, the moving of the Holy Ghost in our life, a call of God to say, listen, I know man going to decide for you what you're going to be and what you're going to do when you're my people. Give me a break. When you come over and you put your trust in me, I'll decide what you're going to do and what you're going to be. And I've already decided you're going to be blessed.
Yes.
I've already decided. I'll tell you right now, I'll make you great. I've got great plans for you.
Yes.
I don't have no small plans.
Right. Let's just read the rest of this verse. I've lost my Bible. In my pilgrimage. Ah. Are we in 2 Corinthians?
Yes. And I just want to encourage you, as you're fasting and praying tomorrow, just begin to look at the contrast especially between what it looks like to have a hardened heart. How was this the case? That his disciples that were with him, how was it that they continually had hardened hearts? All the way to the very end. They were slow to believe. But they stayed with him. They stayed with him. And in his mercy, he opened up their understanding. He opened up their eyes. They're like, whoa! Look at what we've been living in. Look at who we've been living with. We're with God. We've been with God. Do you realize that we just spent the past 3 years with God? And they got to sit there and talk to each other about this. For the first couple of years, we were with God. We had no idea we were with God. We knew it was great. It was wonderful. It was amazing. But it just never sunk in. You with me?
Yes.
It just never sunk in. I mean, we did signs. We did wonders. The devils were subject to us through his name. It was amazing. But he was God. We had God with us. God. G-O-D. God. The living God with us. We ate with him. We slept with him. People, let me give you some good news. We're on the other side of Pentecost, so it's easier for us to get a hold of this and come to the revelation of it and the God consciousness of it, no longer to be healed under the laws of men. As long as you choose to be healed under the framework and the laws that govern men, of finances, of physical health, of human restraint, of the miraculous versus just living out a natural life. If you're living out a natural life, the miraculous is super hard. How are we going to, we're going to have to believe God for a miracle. Oh, no, has it come to that? Oh, this is going to be hard. This is hard. You've been living as a mere human being in your doubt and unbelief and hardness of heart. There is no yieldness to God. There's very little relationship there. Because if there were, it would be normal. It would be an everyday occurrence. It's like, hey, Jesus is here. Yeah, we're no problem. We're on the other side of the sea already. Just get out the boat. What's next? Yeah. It would just be an expectation. Man, are we going to fly over there or are we walking? Lord, are we flying or are we walking? Are we being translated, or do we have to walk? Why should we have to walk, Lord, when we can be translated? None of the disciples were doing that. Why should we have to walk when we can be translated? It would have been great if he would have had those kind of complaints going on. He had just the opposite. You got to be kidding me. We were translated. They were just expecting a human solution. They were expecting Jesus to get in the boat and row. an extra pair of hands. Probably put him to paddling. See, as he's a carpenter from Nazareth. No. We with God here, people. I say, we with God here.
Yes.
Your eyes, God wants to open up your eyes. He wants to show you how to guard against mind-blinding spirits and wrong influences, things that will take your brain, your mind, your thinking, your predictions captive.
Yes.
To where it becomes hard for you to believe that God's going to do this for you. No, people. Father wants it the other way around.
Yes.
Come on. Father wants it the other way around.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to get this.
Yeah.
I'm going to get this. Amen. I'm going to get this. You know, I'm so blessed with what Kelly Lejeune is doing right now. Let's talk about Kelly for just a minute. Love him so much. It's like a son. And, you know, and the bottom line of it is everywhere he's going, he's got favor with the biggest churches. The largest church in Kenya is hosting his crusade in Kenya, paying all expenses. The largest church, I think, in Uganda is actually hosting him in Uganda on the border of southern Sudan. Then, you know, the last church that hosted him in Kenya was the second largest church in Mombasa. It's just beautiful. Why? He said, one day he says to me, he says, Pastor, I feel the fire. I got to go. Can I go? I said, go. And he ran. And he ran without any money. No money in the bank. None. None in the bank. So I'm so ready. But what was he doing in the ministry? He was already ministering.
Yeah.
What you're going to do right now sets the precedent of what you're going to do later.
Yeah.
What you're willing to do.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
When I ask you if you're doing the work of the evangelist, everybody's raising their hand going, yeah. It's because it ought to be like me saying, are you living the life of Jesus? Yeah. Well, then how can you be saying, I'm living the life of Jesus, you're not living the life of an evangelist? Your wires are crossed up, man. There's some serious issues here. Cognitive issues. I don't care how smart you are. You got some cognitive issues. Hello. You can't be saying, I'm after the ministry of Jesus. And saying, you know, I might be doing the work of evangelists. It's just like, please, people, the life and the ministry of Jesus encompasses it all. To say that you're living the life of Jesus is better than to call yourself an apostle.
Yeah.
I'm living the life of Jesus. That's higher than saying, I'm an apostle. I'm functioning in the ministry of Jesus. That's higher than any other credential that you could have ascribed to you and labeled by men upon your life. There was not one person sitting in the boat going, you know, I expected this to happen. There was no one sitting in the boat going, no, guys, don't worry. That's Jesus. It's Jesus. Boats are guys! Ah! It's a guy! My grandfather told me just before you die, you see these guys. That's what they were doing. Jesus is like rolling his eyes. My goodness. Fear not. It's me. It's really me. He's saying it to you and me right now. He's saying, fear not. I'm saying, Lord, I want to speak for you accurately. Fear not, it's me. Lord, when I step into the platform next month in Texas, in that church in Texas, I want great signs and wonders and miracles, the great exploits of it. Fear not, it's me.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Because I've gone from that to, I know there will be. Why? Because my expectation has been changed based upon what He's already done, and my knowledge that He is God with me, and that He's a faithful God, and that this is what He's purposed to do. So I know what's going to happen. I'm not worried about it. I'm going to go to sleep. I'm going to snore. I'm going to eat. I'm going to be eating then. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's nothing when you start thinking about, I'm going to eat one day. I can't wait till I eat. It's kind of a new perspective of life. Perspective on life. Hallelujah. God is good. God, He's so good. He's so good. Oh, and He just wants us to know how good He is. He's all powerful. He's got all provision. And He's not somehow just going to throw you the scraps. He's just waiting for you to believe, because He can't get it to you until you'll agree with Him and believe. He cannot. It will not work. It doesn't work that way. You got to start agreeing with His Word, speaking His Word. You got to start thinking His Word. Your meditations have got to be the meditations that He has created for us in His Word. And then all of a sudden, your eyes will be open. You'll see that you're living in another realm, a realm called heaven, and all that God has is yours. And then it's just flowing out of you now. It's just flowing. It's flowing out of you. It's flowing to you. My. Everything Satan tries to do, you reverse it, you change it, you annihilate it, you stop it. You don't allow any effect on yourself, on people around you. No weapon formed against you is able to prosper. Why? Because you just stand around the presence of God. You stand around in His goodness. Stand around in His fire. I got something better than a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. I have His glory. I have His person. His personal presence. He's with me and in me. And it causes me to know for certainty what will happen tomorrow. What will happen in this night. Ooh. And every day I'm growing in it. Hallelujah. And I'm looking forward to the maturity and the growth that is going to be in my life in just a few years from now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, I'm not going to get left out of nothing. I'm not left out of nothing.
Amen.
I'm going to get in it.
Amen.
Somebody else is doing it, I'm going to be another player. That's scoot right. Over. Yeah. Make room over here. Yeah. Instead of sitting back going, I missed it. I missed it. Yeah. I could have been. Could have been a contender. Nonsense, man. I'm doing this.
That's right.
And regardless whether I missed it or not, it's irrelevant.
Amen.
I got it now.
Amen.
Scoot over.
Amen.
I'm in the midst of it right now.
Come on.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
God's the God of the second chance, third chance, fourth chance, 100th chance, 1,000th, 10,000th. Try again.
That's right.
Go ahead. Try again. And He's saying, I promise you, you can do this. He's not saying, he's not just sitting there making fun of us. Look, you're never going to get it done. Look, forget about it. You might as well just give it up. Go ahead, try again if you want. He's saying, I'm telling you, I promise you, you can do this. I empower you to do this. Listen to me right now. You have my strength and my divine ability. You can do this. This is yours. I've already given it to you. It's free. It's yours. It's already yours. And we're sitting there going, really? Truly? It is? Are you sure? And He's so long-suffering and patient. He's going, yeah, I am. I'm sure. I really know what I'm talking about. Believe me. You know, Paul lays out here that a lot of people's ministry is nothing more but in league and cooperation with mind-blinding spirits. That's what the first two verses is about. It is. He says, listen, he says, therefore, seeing that we have this ministry as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And he's really dealing with people who are handling the word of God deceitfully, speaking out of their own thoughts, out of their own ideas. He's going to deal with it more by the time he gets to the 11th chapter. But he's saying, we're faithfully ministering to you what God says about you. And anything that God has given to us and made provision for us to have of all that belongs to him, because the Holy Spirit is coming. If the Holy Spirit is ministering, he's telling you everything the Father has is at your disposal. You can use it. It's for you. It's yours. You can move in it. Amen. All that the Father has, he's taking and showing us how to move in it, Amen. Function in it, live Amen. In it. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen.
All the divine power, all divine ability. Amen. That's what the Holy Ghost is doing. And he says, if you don't understand this, it's because you got mind-blinding spirits messing with you, hiding the gospel, working in your life, blinding your mind so that you can't understand. You cannot get it. You can't remember. Lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ is the image of God should shine into them. And of course, here he's dealing purely with the loss. But we have to understand, people, it's not just with the loss. And that is the extreme. The reality of it is that that's where the battle goes on for us. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus, the Lord, and ourselves, your servants for Jesus' sake. And once again, he is dealing with those people who are preaching themselves. And this is telling it the way they perceive it to be and what they think is rational and what they think happened. He says, no. We're declaring it to you just like God is saying it, just like he said it. And he lays out to them, he says, listen, you got to understand, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined into our heart to give us this revelation, to give us this knowledge, to open up our eyes, to give us this ability to see and understand and cooperate with him and function with him in the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. And we have this treasure in these earthen vessels that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Yes. He's bringing us into a realm, people, of recognizing that we've been fully vested and fully resourced. Yes. But unless you believe that you've been fully vested and fully resourced, and you're willing now to walk this out with the Holy Ghost, obeying the word of God, it's never going to be revealed to you. You're never going to be a beneficiary because you never participated. Fear, you drew back with unbelief. Fear paralyzed you and kept you from moving forward in the life of God. It's about time you deal with the spirit of fear.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
And the only way you deal with the spirit of fear, once again, comes back to relationship, because perfect love casts out all the fear.
Amen.
You just live and dwell in God's love. Just a big part of living and dwelling in God's love is you and I worshiping him, interacting with him. It's relationship driven, people. And if there's anything that you want to get a revelation to, is that it's a relationship. It's an intimacy. God loves you. He's with you. When that becomes a reality to you and you sit in before you and he's on your right hand, that you should not be moved. And all of a sudden you recognize that he's there and acknowledging and recognizing and seeing and being a part of everything that's going on in your life, even to the point of numbering the hairs upon your head. He cares for you that much. He's aware of when you sit down and when you rise up. He's aware right now of me. And he's now still aware of me. And he's aware of me again. And then now he's still aware with me. When I said to get up, get down, he's aware of all my uprisings and my down cities. I'm blessed when I go in. I'm blessed when I come out. So I just walk out the house. I'm blessed. Walk back in the house, I'm blessed. I'm going to go for a double blessing. I'm going to walk back out of the house, I'm blessed. I'm going to walk back in the house, I'm blessed. Because I have embraced this. I've embraced this. And everything that says it's not so, I have the ability, I have supernatural weaponry and power to destroy its influence in my life.
Yes.
Instead of being passive to it and just allowing it to overrun me. And acting like it's just normal. It's a normal process of thinking. This is the way all the rest of men think. But you're not supposed to think like men.
Right.
You're supposed to be thinking like God. You're not supposed to be thinking as those who are just human beings. You're supposed to be thinking like those who are born of the Spirit. You're not supposed to have the mind of man. You're supposed to have the mind of God, the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit. When is it? Where is the break point? Your obedience.
Yes, sir.
Because obedience is going to always result in revelation. Faithfulness will always result in revelation. You give yourself to the Word of God, and He will open up your eyes to behold wondrous things out of the Word that you did not know, that no one else knew either. You all of a sudden begin to walk with Him. You get yourself into crisis points over and over again. We see people get themselves into crisis points in the Bible, and their eyes are open. I'm not going to preach the sermon that I preached this morning. I'm not going to redo it. You have to go listen to it. But it's so important to getting what I'm saying right now. It's absolutely the reality. If you want to walk in this place of divine revelation as a person with his eyes open, who's able to see that God really reigns here, He's really right here, He's present, He's there to resource us in Paris, you're going to have to be willing then to recognize that there are a lot of things coming at you that are going to try to make that invalid.
Yes.
That are going to harden your heart, desensitize you to God. That are going to work on you in such a way to where you don't know how to be yielded to Him because He's too far away from you to be yielded. Yielded is a state of Him being nearby and close. Huh? Yeah. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
As I heard one brother, dear brother, say, When you know He's near, you can start calling and you'll begin to discover some answers you never knew possible. Call upon the Lord while He is near. Because people trying to call upon God when they still think He's far, far away. Well, I don't feel the presence of God. I don't know if He's hearing me. Oh, but what happens when all of a sudden you're in the movings of God? And the manifest presence of God is there. You start calling and there's a faith realm that is released through your life because He's right there. He encountering Him. You're not just speaking out in the air hoping that the message arrives. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for opening up our eyes. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for opening up our eyes. You've seen the scripture many times, and I'm going to go ahead and point out to you one more time. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Paul says the verse, chapter 10, verse 3 says, "For though we walk after the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." And the understanding that we have fleshly lust warring against us, that we have mind-blinding spirits warring against us, that we have spiritual wickedness warring against us, and the very focus of the war is that you and I never start walking as manifested sons of God. That the glorious liberty that is revealed in the manifested sons of God, those who living out the life of Jesus, is so unstoppable that the only thing that Satan has to grasp at is that he can kill it before it exists. He can stop it before it happens. We got to understand what the war is. We got to understand his subtle tactics and all the things that we allow to influence our life. You're going to have to stop. Let me just help you real make this real simple. You can't have no more influencers but God's Word.
Amen.
Let's make it real simple. If it's not God's Word and it's influencing you, it is going to result in something bad. It's going to result, worst case, your destruction. Even the best case, your inability to yield to God, walk with Him, perceive. Parent needs to go with them. Huh? That was your kids. Up and go with them before the toilets don't work anymore. If your children leave the church service, I hate to have to stop, but after the Lord did this, and it's a perfect example of how the Lord deals with us. He says it over and over and over again. He posts signs. He declares it, and we still don't get it. So he just has to stop and say, "Hello, your name. This is you. Get up and do what I've told you to do." And God's good to do it.
Amen.
He's good to do it. But we still got to be willing to listen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
If I told some people that, they'd never come back to the meeting because they feel like they publicly insulted, because the pride of life has such a stronghold in their life. Everything about them is, everything in the world is about them and how everybody's treating them. And it doesn't matter whether they are obeying or disobeying, they want to be treated as though that they are right. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not your Huckleberry. I'm not your pastor, because I'm going to tell you where you're wrong.
Yes, sir.
And some of you, I'm just giving you a break for a little while. I'm giving you a break. And I'm going to come at you. Amen. I'm going to let you know your spirit's not right. Amen. You're not right. There's a couple of people in here. You're going to get some shaking. You think you, there's a couple of people in here that think that they got it all going on. I tell you right now, you don't have it all going on. Amen. Who's got your kids, just by the way? Oh, okay. Just, you need to usher them out. Thank you. Love you very much. No kids can be unescorted in this house. You know, I've just, so many times I've walked into the restaurant. I know that people need to go. I know there's people going in and out. That's fine. Just as long as everybody recognizes, here is the rules. Okay? You don't ever want to leave your kids alone for any reason, ever. They need you. God gave them to you for you to always have them right by your side. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All the time.
Amen.
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 Thank you, Jesus. Everybody stand with me. I'm going to read this to you while you're standing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now I'm going to tell you what we're getting ready to do. We're getting ready to lay hands on everybody in this house. I want to believe, I'm believing God and want to believe with you, but you, and this is really, getting Father to agree with me is no problem, because I'm going to be doing things really out of agreement with Him. So you understand? If I'm doing things out of agreement with Him, there's no problem to get Him to agree with me, because I'm already, you with me?
Yeah.
The problem is getting you to agree.
Yes. Amen.
The problem is getting you to say, wait a minute, I see this, I want it. I want to understand the proper connection in the church. I want to understand the proper connection with the anointing. I heard Phil say the other day, and it was just so good, it's worthy of being repeated. He said, a guy came out to Overland's Missions at Rapids 14, and he had his little notebook out, and he had his pencil out, and he said, how did you do this? As though he was going to be able to take notes and write down a sequence of events that was going to result in this great miracle that has taken place in Overland's Missions. And Phil said, how can I tell him that I've never had a cross word or a bad feeling towards my pastor in 25 years? How can I tell him that this happens because I honor the anointing and I'm properly connected with the church? And the man that led me to God, the man that led me to the Lord, some 34 years ago, I've never violated in any way relationship with Him, but have been honoring Him every day since that first encounter. How do I tell him these principles that most people don't want to have anything to do with? That's what results in greatness in God. I want you to stand there and think about it for a minute. A preacher said, if you do not know how to honor the anointed men of God, you do not know how to honor the anointing. In any dream or vision that you have in God is a fantasy that will never come to pass. It's true. And so he said, can you give me a verse of scripture that says exactly that? I can give you many verses of scripture that says that, that implies that. And we ask, why is it that we can't do the simple relational things? because of the attacks of mind-blinding spirits, of our own perceptions and of our own ideas and own predictive models and our own experiences, that we're not willing to submit to God and allow it to be broken off of us and no longer be the governor over our life and that which controls the reins of our decisions. So at some point, you and I have got to say, wait a minute, I'm going to give my life over to God. I'm going to give my life over to the Holy Spirit. I'm going to let the Holy Spirit rule me. I'm going to let the Word of God decide my behavior, my action, my responses in every situation. I'm no longer going to speak out of my own understanding. I'm going to prophesy what God says. I'm going to declare what He's spoken. My confession is going to be what God has spoken. Oh, can you get your confessions right? People had all kinds of problems with the confession. You need to get, what we're talking about is how you speak. I told a young preacher the other day, I'm just so blessed to be allowed of God to be able to be a part of so many ministers' lives. And the Lord's just done that. He's given me favor with preachers and ministers. And you know, the thing that the Lord put in my mouth for him is, listen, you know, because the Lord had already showed me how God was going to use him in an amazing way. The Lord showed me in a vision how God was going to use him. It was an audible vision, audible seeing vision, like a dream. And I said, because of where God, and I'm saying this to you as well, I'm telling you this story because it applies to you. I said, because of where you're at and where God's going to take you, you have to now step into a greater submission of speaking the word only. Because where Father wants to take you, it's going to be just a threshold. It's going to be great, but it's going to be a threshold of the greatness that you get to step into. If you do it right, you've got to stop speaking your own words, speaking your own ideas, spinning your own opinion. You've got to disregard yourself as though somehow you're sufficient of yourself. Now I'm moving beyond what I told him because I'm now talking to you. I'm talking to you. There's not a single person in this place that God does not have a great plan. Understand this. I'm going to say this first. All that God has planned and purposed and written and predestinated for our lives in Christ Jesus does not even come into play until we're born again, because before that we're dead. Right. You're dead! You can't live out God's plan, living plan of life, when you're dead. There's no part of it. There's no part of it. But when we are born again, there is this plan and this destiny that Father has demanded that we conform to. Once again, when you talk about conform, that is a suggestion of your will. To conform means that you're going to participate with it and choose to participate with it or not. And you've got to reckon with God. You've got to get real with God and you've got to reckon with the reality of whether or not you're participating with the life and ministry of Jesus or whether you're playing games. Because truth is a beautiful thing in the inward parts, and Father's going to hook up with the truth. And you would say, oh Lord, I'm living your life and I'm living your ministry, and you're doing nothing. But if you turn chain around and say, Lord, wait, I want to be conformed to you. I want to live your life. I want my life to count. Oh God, I want to be used by you. I really don't even know how to start in obedience. He's going to say, well, then submit to the church and submit to your leadership and you can start. Amen. Oh, well, I mean, there's a lot of people are sorted out at that door, if you would. They're sorted out right there. They don't even get to move forward. Right there, they're stuck. And it's high-mindedness. Or it's deception, mind-blinding spirits. Somebody's trying to tell you the truth. They're trying to tell you what's wrong, but you can't see it because you're blinded. There's a blind spot. You call it a blind spot. It's a mind-blinding spirit. You want God's miracles? Speak His word. Amen. You want God's life? Speak His word. You want His blessings? Speak His word. Amen. You want to walk with Him? Find yourself giving thanks and rejoicing and praising Him. Because one thing you're going to discover, and Ann and I are constantly discovering it and just being, you know, not astonished by it, but in awe of Him. And that is that He's got our year already planned out. And it's bigger than that. And we find ourselves literally at a moment in time that everything converged to bring us to that moment in time over and over again, where we look and go, whoa, this was planned. This is not a random set of events. This, He turned me here, He turned me there, He did this, He did that, He woke me up in the night, made this decision to ultimately result in this one thing and another thing and the other, to find ourselves right there in the middle of His greatness. Yeah. Oh man, you and I want that. Yeah. We want that. But it's an act of obedience to say, Lord, I want to be used by You. Yeah. You know, this whole time where we're fasting and praying, you know, some people like to break up the 21-day fast into 3 segments, 7 days you're doing praying about this thing, 7 days about these. For me, I kind of just mix it all together. I function better that way. You know, and I just cry out to God. I'm just saying, Father, I've just got to be used by You. I've got to touch You. I've got to know this realm. I've got to be able to understand how to minister to Your presence more effectively. I've got to understand how to be more yielded to You. I don't want to be hardened against You in any way. I want to learn sensitivity. Oh God, this is more important to me than anything. I don't want to have any kind of corrupt thoughts running in my mind. I want to be able, Lord, to stop any kind of thoughts, no matter what they are, doubt, unbelief, whatever they could possibly be, before they ever even take up root. The enemy tries to impose upon our minds some kind of thoughts of immorality, some kinds of thoughts of offense, some kind of thoughts of unforgiveness, try to rerun something that happened in our life long ago that has no bearing upon us, to try to take away our boldness and our confidence. I want to shut those things down with such effectiveness. Lord, I want to be able to perceive when I'm being influenced by fear and making a decision out of fear. I want to be able to perceive when I'm being influenced by something that offended me, and then making decisions out of offense. All these various different things. I want to be able to perceive when I'm making a decision out of self-preservation or insecurity. I want to be able to perceive it before it runs amok, and I'm making decisions, and there's actions, and there's. So He says, "Listen, hold fast to My word. The word, you know, is take a firm grip on eternal life. Take a firm grip on Jesus. Take a firm grip on the things of the Spirit of God." So many people just make this as something less important than their other affairs. That is the biggest error and mistake of your life. You will never even come close to walking with God like that. There is so much advantage for Satan to have over you, and God's called us into a place where we give Satan no advantage, where we understand the fleshly lust at war against our soul. I understand this. I am aware of this, that the pride of life, in its most subtle ways, is there trying to influence me. And if I don't, I am ignorant. I am going in the middle of an army that I think is friends. I have no defense. I understand. And I'm going to tell you, that's the most subtle. The pride of life. I understand the pride of life that wants to influence what I speak, what I think, my behavior. I understand the lust of the eye, of where all of a sudden I want to be influential of my own self for my own purposes. I want people to recognize me. I want to have these particular things in life so that I get those types of responses out of men around me that is common to humanity. I realize those things would come at me. I realize that's the lust of the eye. I'm at war against it. How am I going to know that the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and pride of life is not going to influence me? I'm going to give myself to brokenness and humility and walking in a place of saying, Lord, I'm depending upon You, obeying His word. If I give any place in any opportunity, people sit around and they soak themselves in the filth of the world that comes through the media, that comes through television. And then they're just vulnerable. They're just vulnerable. They've not been in communion with God. There's been no ministry to the Spirit of the Lord. There's been no expressions of the hunger of their heart. Read the Bible? No problem. I read the Bible last Thursday. What more do you want? No. You eat every day?
Yes.
You don't understand how important and how more important it is for you to partake of spiritual food. It's going to open up your eyes. His word will enlighten you.
Yes, sir.
It will cause you to see what's really going on. It's a connect with God. There's a connection that goes on with the Spirit of the Lord there that causes you now to be yielded instead of hard or distant or aloof from Him. And then what people got to basically wreck, and slide across the road on their face doing a face plant and wake up, oh man, I miss God. And that's the only time you come to your senses. It's like a mule who needs a bridle, and a bit, and a whip. You got to have road burn on your face before you get it. Oh no, I was listening to the wrong things. Hold up, God wants you to be sensitive, not hard.
Yes.
Give yourself to the Word. Don't even start your day tomorrow until you open up the Bible.
That's right.
Now, what's going to happen is for some people, that is going to be a dramatic change. And all that's showing you is that you don't have much of a relationship with God. But that's the problem. It's a dramatic change. You mean I got to have? Yes. And it shouldn't be I got to have. There should be a hunger, the Son, Spirit of the Son crying out. I'm hungry for you, Lord. Speak to me. I loved to read His Word because I love the sound of His voice. Oh, come on now. I pray that everybody in this place is cooperating with me and doing what's right as we've given you guidance and instruction. And you're not on social media. And you're not sitting there watching television, listening to the radio, listening to the news. You cut all secular things off, radio, everything. Because if you don't do what we say to do, if you're not willing to partake with us, then you're not willing to connect with us. And if you're not willing to connect with us, you have no connection to the divine, so says the Lord. Ephesians is about that. 1 Peter is about, a lot of scriptures about that. How are you going to move forward with God when you're not willing to cooperate with your leadership? And going to another church isn't going to remedy it because if they even give you anything to do, you probably won't do it there either. And more than likely, they're not going to give you much to do because the status quo is don't put any responsibility on people and they'll come back. Don't put them on any kind of pressure, Powder, baby powder their pew, Give them coffee. Require nothing of them. And if you do, pay them a double salary so that they can be hirelings. Unfortunately, I'm sorry I have to say that, but it's just the state of the status quo. Just hook up with what God is doing. Just hearken into the voice of the Lord. This isn't hard. Just follow us. If you cannot follow us, you have to recognize that you are a rebellious person. Because by definition, a rebel, something that is hard, something that is walking in some kind of a deceit, will not follow the shepherd. They will not follow. They're going to do it their own way if it's convenient for them, and if they agree, then they'll do it. But if there's not convenient for them and they don't agree, they won't do it. We get to find out whether or not you're following leadership when it's not convenient for you and you don't agree. Phil was saying, how could I tell this person who wants to take notes that my pastor told me when I was ready to start to go do this that I wasn't allowed to do it, that I had to come and sit in the church for 2 years and start a business? And though I knew God called me to the missions and was going to do this great work, I obeyed my pastor I sat in the church for 2 years and started a business that became a success overnight, with hundreds of thousands of dollars flooding in, like on a monthly basis kind of thing. It was originally success. Raging successful. How do you help people understand that that's the kind of walk that God demands before he's going to use a man? And he's been in the same church now that has been hosting the offices, and they just bought offices, and he was saying, you know, I'm conflicted because here we're moving out of the church and we're moving in this great building that they were able to buy. It's just amazing, the blessing of the Lord. He says, but I'm just conflicted because I feel like I'm moving out from underneath the canopy of the church. And I got to stay in the canopy of the church. I got to know I'm under the canopy of the church. I've heard Phil say this a number of times, and some of you have heard him say it. You are listening to someone who describes to you the keys to moving with God and success. It's really about your relationships that are around you. And there's various different dimensions of the relationship. And this is one of the most high, this is one of the more important ones before the Lord. The way that you interact with the divine leadership that God has placed in your life for your perfection, for your growth and maturity. The way that you interact with your husband and your wife. I'm gonna tell you right now, I understand it more than I've ever understood it. I'm more into laying down my life and serving this holy woman of God than ever before, making sure that, because she'd never tell you if she's got a need or a problem or an issue. So it makes it a little bit more challenging. I have to make sure I'm taking care of her. Because that is a relationship that if I violate that and if it's wrong, I don't get to move forward. I am now compromised. I'm going to be more influenced by mind-blinding spirits and things that are going to be preventing me from moving forward. And it was my own decisions that I made. And that's why Peter said, dwell with your wives according to knowledge, lest your prayers be hindered. God ain't got to hear you. He got to hear you. It's like, no. I love you, but you get yourself right. You do what I tell you to do. I'm not answering any of your prayers until you do what I tell you to do. I'm not moving forward. You want me to go take you over here? I'm not taking you over there. You do what's right. And I would be totally remiss to talk to you today about stepping in this place where your eyes are open, helping you to understand those things, that those adversaries that come out against us, these things of logic and rational thinking of men, in addition to mind-blinding spirits. If I don't just tell you the simple things that are around us right now that we're going to have to take care of, you better know how to take care of it. There are some of you, I've told you to hug every person in this place, and I've watched you, and Father's watched you. You did not. You did not. You did not do it. It was not convenient to you, and you didn't believe you had to, and you didn't feel like it. And so you are living your own life under your own demands, by your own will, regardless of what God says. And you're not going to move on until you change that. It's not a condemnation. If it's a condemnation, it would be flat. That's you. That's it. You're messed up. You're done. It's not a condemnation. It's an instruction that says, you cannot live that way anymore. You're going to remain sick. You're going to remain tormented, and it will get worse. Believe me. And no one wants that. No one wants that. People constantly have all kinds of problems, and it was their own decisions. And God never asked too difficult of thing. He never did. We didn't say, everybody get up there, climb up on the balcony, do 30 pull-ups. And if you slip, it's a long ways to fall. We told you to go and hug everybody in the house. Twice. At the beginning of this, starting in this year, the Lord is having me do it. To sort things out. He wants to sort it out. He wants to divide the sheep from the goat, the chaff from the wheat, the light from the darkness, the obedient from the disobedient, the righteous from the unrighteous. People are always under these things from heaven, and they have no ability to perceive that it was God trying their heart. They're so used to just walking out their own life, they don't know that their decisions have consequence. And tonight, I pray in Jesus' name that you get it. Yes. That you get it, and you say, wait a minute, I'm never gonna live my own life anymore. I'm gonna be submitted, I'm gonna be a servant. I'm gonna obey, I'm not gonna live it my own way anymore. I'm not gonna violate the things of God anymore. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just looking at you guys, you ladies, because I just see the anointing. I usually look at people, I see a good thing on them. There'll be a day where we'll come to a place where, you know, if a person is demon possessed and we go to them and we cast out the devil and we deliver them from that evil spirit, they're so thankful. But if a Christian is stubborn and rebellious and we try to go and deliver them, they hate us for it. They're offended. Don't let there be one person like that in this place.
Amen.
That's a good amen. And it needs to be a stronger amen.
Amen.
That's good. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.